We invite you to find your seats as we sing together our gathering song. Welcome. We have much to celebrate and reflect upon this morning. We gather with friends and family of Robin and Zach and Archer and Cole, both their biological family and the family of God represented here at New Life, to celebrate God's faithfulness and to celebrate the baptism of Cole, a tangible expression of God's love and faithfulness to them and to us. We also gather to continue our Easter celebrations because we are an Easter people, and Easter is not just one day. It's a season and a reality that changes everything. In the words of Richard Rohr, the resurrection is not Jesus' private miracle. It's the new shape of reality. It's the new shape of the world. It's filled with grace. It's filled with possibility. It's filled with newness. So welcome, not just from those of us representing New Life here, from myself, Sharon Buisman, and Herman Vanderkooy as worship leaders, and the team up here, and all those participating, but also in the name of God. So let's stand as we receive God's greeting. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. In God, in his God's great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And I invite you to greet one another now, especially those that are visiting among us, so we can get to know each other. So let's just take a moment to greet each other. words of Ilia Delio, "Where is the risen Christ? Everywhere and all around us. In you, your neighbor, the trees outside that are beginning to bud, the tulips and daffodils bursting forth in color, the ants popping up through the cracks, the shadows, darkness, and light created by the solar eclipse, the birth of a child. The whole world is filled with God who is shining through even the darkest places of our lives. To go to church is to awaken to this divine presence in our midst and respond in love with a yes. Your life, O God, is my life and the life of this planet."
Thank you.
Let's pray together. God, we give you praise and celebrate your victory through your death and resurrection. We cannot fathom such love revealed in Jesus, giving him of himself to the very last breath, giving and forgiving. Praise the Lord. Amen. As we sing the next song, Nailed to the Cross, I invite you to sing it as a song of confession, assurance, and hope.
It is a great joy this morning to participate in and to witness the baptism of Cole Alexander Dykstra. We come as a people of God, as God's covenant people, and that is why we do baptisms together. So we hear the words of Jesus commanding us to to do this sacrament. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Why do we come together to do this sacrament of baptism today? We do this because of who God is, a covenant-making and a covenant-keeping God. And we do it because of who we are, who we profess to be, God's covenant people. So before we baptize Cole, we take a moment to remind ourselves of our story by remembering just some of God's covenants with his people found in Scripture. In the beginning, the Holy Spirit moved over the waters, and God created everything that is, seen and unseen. In the time of Noah, God destroyed evil in the waters of the flood, and by his saving ark, he gave a new beginning. In the night of terror and trouble, God led Israel through the waters of the sea, out of slavery and into freedom in the promised land. In the waters of the Jordan, our Lord was baptized by John and anointed by the Holy Spirit. In the baptism of Christ's death and resurrection, we are set free from sin and death, and the way is opened up to eternal life. In this sacrament of baptism, God gives us a new identity as his covenant people. For when we are baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, the triune God seals our adoption as his children and writes his name invisibly on our foreheads, as we read in 1 Peter 2. You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. By baptism, we have a new identity with Christ. So as we pray this prayer of thanksgiving, let us now remember our baptisms and give thanks to God as we celebrate this sacrament of baptism for Cole today. Let us pray. We thank you, O God, for our baptism into Christ's death and resurrection. We thank you for your faithfulness to our rebellious ancestors, to our own doubting hearts, and to unseen generations yet to come. May Christ, who sank deep into death and was raised Lord of life, keep us and our little ones in the grip of his hand. May your Spirit separate us from sin and mark us with a faith that can stand the light of day and endure the dark of night. To you be all honor and glory, dominion and power, now and forever, through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. And now, as we have remembered God's promises, we invite Robin and Zach and Cole and Archer, if you want Archer to come up, to respond by making their own covenant promises. You can join me up here. Robin and Zach, since you have presented Cole for holy baptism, you are asked to answer the following questions before God and his people. After all three questions, you're invited to respond together with, "We do, God helping us." First, do you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, accept the promises of God, and affirm the truth of the Christian faith, which is proclaimed in the Bible and confessed in this Church of Christ? Second, do you believe that Cole, while sinful by nature, is received by God in Christ as a member of his covenant, and therefore ought to be baptized? Third, do you promise, in reliance on the Holy Spirit and with the help of the Christian community, to do all in your power to instruct him in the Christian faith and lead him by your example to be Christ's disciple? Robin and Zach, what is your answer Amen. Thanks be to God. Our Lord said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." So I invite all the children present now to come forward so that you have a front row view of the baptism that's about to happen. You can come and sit maybe around here. Yeah, you can come sit. You can come sit right up here, maybe on the steps. You got to be able to see, okay? You don't want this to block you. Can you guys see the water in here? When we baptize, this is a sign and a seal of God's love for baby Cole and for his whole family and for all of you. So we remember if you are baptized as well. Cole Alexander Dykstra, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Yeah, I know. Cole, child of the covenant, in baptism you are sealed with the Holy Spirit and marked as Christ's own. People of God, I invite you to stand. This is a community and a covenantal promise that we also make to Cole and to his family. Fellow children of God, sisters and brothers in Christ, we now receive Cole into Christ's church family. I charge you to nurture and to love him and to assist him in becoming Christ's faithful disciple. With joy and thanksgiving, we now welcome you into Christ's church, for we are all one in Christ. To love, encourage, and support you, and to help you follow Christ. Amen. You may be seated. So one way at New Life that your New Life family offers you offers our love and support to you and to Cole and to Archer is that we share this candle lighting tradition. So I'm going to sneak by. This candle here is lit every Sunday, and it's called the Christ candle, and it's a sign of Christ's presence and the Holy Spirit's presence in our midst. So we light this candle from the Christ candle today to symbolize that Cole is now filled with the Holy Spirit and part of God's family. So we will give you a candle to take home today that you can light. We encourage you to light it every year or more often on the anniversary of Cole's baptism and of Archer's baptism, that as a reminder, teaching them about the promises God has made to them, of the promises you have made, and about a reminder that you and they are part of God's family and a part of this family as the people of God. We also have for you a baptismal certificate to remember this by, and a Bible, a children's Bible, to help you and assist you as you help these little ones know and love God. Do you want to hold this one? Can you hold that? Awesome. It's a good book for you to read together with your brother. So now it is time for us to pray a blessing on baby Cole and on his family. So I am going to ask you, have you ever seen a pastor up front here raise their hands to bless the congregation? That's sometimes what people do in church, right? So you have an important role here. You too have made promises to Cole. And I invite you to put your hands out towards him and towards his family during this prayer so that you too are part of blessing Cole. Can you do that, giving God's blessing to him? So you can raise your hands as we pray, okay? Gracious God and Heavenly Father, We thank you that you make us new persons in Jesus Christ through grace alone. We pray for Cole. Bless and strengthen him daily with the gift of your Holy Spirit. As he gets older, unfold to him the riches of your love. Deepen his faith. Keep him from the power of evil. Enable him to live a holy and blameless life until your kingdom comes. Look with kindness on Robin and Zach. Let them rejoice in the children you have given them and grant them patience and grace in their lives and parenting. Grant them the presence of your Holy Spirit that they may bring up Cole and Archer to know you, love you, and serve you and their neighbors. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Another tradition with baptisms here at New Life is that during the baptismal song, which today is baptized in water, chosen by Robin and Zach, I will come and sort of present and introduce Cole to the congregation. It's noteworthy that there is a sign of, Cole is wearing a sign of God's covenant faithfulness, which is the baptismal gown, which was made by Robin's great-grandmother and has been worn by generations from Robin and Cole's generations in their family. So I invite you kids to sit down, go back, sit down with your families, and then you'll get another peek at Cole, okay?
We're good? All right. Thank you. What a delight and privilege to witness the baptism of Cole this morning. Amazing. Wonderful. It's wonderful to be with friends familiar and friends yet to be known. My name is Kelly Sibthorpe. Just a little bit about me. I am former CRC chaplain at Fanshawe College in London, Ontario. I worked as chaplain there and a colleague of your own, Sarah Damore, during that time. I retired about 4 years ago. My wife and I, Pastor Wilhelmina Zwart, who was here 3 weeks ago, a month ago, something like that. The reason I'm here was because she was invited to come again this Sunday, but she couldn't because she's preaching out in Tilsonburg. And she said to your pulpit supply person, she said, "I can't make it, but if you want my husband, he could come." So here I am with you this morning, and it's a privilege to be here. God is at work, it's obvious, and I'm delighted again that you have extended a call and an overwhelmingly affirmative call to Pastor Jeff Vandermeer. I am proud to say that Pastor Jeff has been my pastor for the last 4 years, and my loss is your gain. I love Jeff. We worked together at Emmanuel CRC in Simcoe for the last 4 years. I helped him preach there, so did Pastor Wilhelmina, and of course giving him a break when he needed it. You are getting a man of God. Jeff is a wonderful, gentle, kind, loving, compassionate, missional man of God, and there's no doubt about that. Words cannot describe for me what Jeff means in my own heart, and I'm so thankful that God has called him to you all here. You will be blessed by his ministry, by his forward-looking, missional approach to church life, and he will take you far as you lean on his guidance and leadership from a pastoral perspective. The Lord bless you as you begin to work with Pastor Jeff. I know that doesn't happen till October. However, lots of time to get ready. This morning we are looking at John's Gospel, chapter 21. John chapter 21. Beginning at the first verse. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas called Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. "I'm going out to fish," Simon Peter told them. And they said, "We'll go with you." So they went out, got into the boat. But that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you'll find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It's the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It's the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and he jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you've just caught." And Simon Peter climbed aboard and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come, have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said, "you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you truly love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep. I tell you the truth. When you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will dress you and lead you to where you do not want to go." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." Peter turned and saw that the disciple whom Jesus loved was following them. This was the one who had leaned back against Jesus at the supper and had said, "Lord, who is going to betray you?" When Peter saw him, he asked, "Lord, what about him?" Jesus answered, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? You must follow me." Because of this, the rumor spread among the brothers that the disciple would not die. But Jesus did not say that he would not die. He only said, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you?" The Lord bless this morning the reading of his word. Let us pray. God, our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Your word is alive. It is truth. It is a light in the darkness. It is a lamp unto our feet. We come to you this morning as Peter was called to be humble before his Lord Jesus. We ask humbly this morning that you would open our hearts to your word, that we might be fed by it, changed, revived, empowered. We pray in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. As we just read, this is the third post-resurrection appearance of Jesus to his disciples. And in so doing, he was attempting to encourage them. They had been discouraged by so many things, and they needed encouragement. And so, in this appearance, we have them returning to the old and familiar. My wife warned me about using technology on the pulpit. Okay, she uses notes. There we go, it's working now. In this third appearance of Christ following his resurrection, he attempts to commission them. And a week before that, he breathed on them and he said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." And then he sent them out and he said, "Whoever sins you forgive, they will be forgiven. And if whoever sins you don't forgive, they are not forgiven." And he even appeared to Thomas, who was absent during the first encounter with the disciples. And even Thomas is given the opportunity to believe by touching Jesus' scars. So they had this call. Jesus had called them, and the disciples are sent out with a gospel to proclaim, peace to offer, and a church to build. The only problem is they do not believe they have what it takes. And so they return to the old and the familiar. They're discouraged. They're living in fear. And so Peter, or a couple of the others, said, "Let's just go fishing. Let's do what we know best." Jesus said, "Go out and forgive sins and heal," and he's commissioned us, but we don't know really how to do that. He's gone. He's not with us anymore. He appears once a week maybe, but we don't feel any power. So let's just go back to the boat and let's throw out the nets and catch some fish. Isn't that just like us? I know when I'm discouraged or I'm feeling lonely or in despair, even when it comes to church life, I go back to the old and familiar. My father, who was a businessman in Port Dover, he had a pretty stressful business. He used to tell me when he was under stress that if it gets to you, if things get to you, he told me this when I was 16. He said, if things get to you in life, whatever it is, just go fishing. Grab the fishing rod and go. Some people know what I'm talking about, don't you? Yeah. But whatever it is that relaxes you or takes you away from the stressful situation, do it. So this is what Peter and the others do. They hang out a sign in front of where the church is supposed to be or where the church is going to be, and it says, gone fishing. They're going back to the old and familiar. And so this is what they do. All day, all night, Peter and the disciples caught nothing. And Jesus told them, as he was walking along the beach, he just says simply, hey guys, throw out the net on the other side. And they're like, what? Who is that? You know, does he know how to fish? Does he know something that we don't? And of course he does, doesn't he? And so they do as he says, and they throw the net on the other side, and the amount of fish they catch is overwhelming them. They can't even pull the net up onto the boat. Second slide, please, Luke. Thank you. Peter and the disciples have wonderful memories of meals with Jesus. Think back to the feeding of the 5,000 when Jesus miraculously multiplies a little boy's lunch. And then they feed 5,000 people. And then they pick up the pieces that remain afterwards. And the baskets are filled to overflowing with what's left. And the disciples are beginning to recall that meals with Jesus are exceptional and wonderful. And the last meal that they had shared with Jesus on the night he was betrayed, not only by Judas, but by all of them, including Peter. And you know what? Peter is beginning to remember how he betrayed his Lord. And so he was demonstrating our Lord Jesus Christ by providing this new meal, this breakfast on the beach, probably 3-4 weeks after his resurrection, that there is a cost to redemption. At the Last Supper, when Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me, every time we gather around a table and we share the bread and the juice or the wine, do this in remembrance of me. They're beginning to recall the cost. They had just gone through the cross, and they realize what a cost to have what we have. He was demonstrating, by providing this new breakfast, the effects and results of setting a table for those you love. By having a deep conversation with Peter, he was beginning to show them what redemption was all about. He's sitting down with those who had betrayed him, and he's sharing a meal with them. Jesus was revealing so many things to them. And what's really curious is the net is full of fish, 153 big fish, the scripture says, and they're trying to pull it in and they can't. And perhaps this new meal of roasting fish and bread over hot coals helps them to understand that their life with Jesus, their life with him, with fish and bread, and a full net, is much better than life without Jesus. And isn't that the same for us? I have tried to run away from God several times. I have tried to go fishing and forget. I have tried to forget that community life, sometimes as difficult as it is worth having. That community life, the life of the church, and what we witnessed this morning, the beautiful baptism into the family of God of Cole, this life that we live together is worth preserving. It's worth sitting down with Jesus and eating fish and bread together with him. And if we have tried to run away by going fishing, we can always come back. We can come back to this little fire where he sits and he talks the beautiful things of this life into our ears. Do you love me? Feed my sheep. Do you love me? Feed my lambs. These are beautiful words in the ears of Peter. So early on in this post-resurrection appearance of Jesus to his own, John's senses are stirred when he sees Jesus far off on the beach, and he says, "It's the Lord." Simon Peter, so anguished by his failure to stand with Jesus at his trial before Pilate, responds excitedly by jumping in the water. He puts on his robe. You see, Peter was naked in the boat because it's hot. I've been to Israel now 3 times and by the Sea of Galilee 3 times, and it's hot. You don't go fishing with your clothes on. If you're fishing all night and hauling nets and rowing, you take your clothes off because you'll sweat if you don't. And so Peter puts his clothes on, and the reason he did, because at that time culturally, if you were seen naked by someone, that was dishonoring to them, not to you, but to them. And so Peter, wanting to honor his Lord, puts his clothes back on, jumps in the water, and comes to the beach. The point is that Peter was naked. We see Peter in his vulnerability. He had just denied Jesus 3 times in front of the court. And now Peter fears that his past will haunt and disqualify him, that he doesn't have what it takes to serve his risen Lord. Jesus sees and he knows all of my fears. And I got a bunch of them, friends. I fear so many things. If I listed all my fears to you, you go, "Why is he up there preaching? Doesn't he have faith?" Yes, I do. Jesus continually comes back to me and reminds me that when I cast all of my cares upon him, as Peter wrote in his epistle years later, after this encounter, he said, "Cast all of your cares on him because he cares for you." 1 Peter 5:7. Peter learned that it's okay. I can trust this man. I may have denied him, but I know now that I can really trust him. He is my risen Lord. Jesus had predicted that Peter would fall and stumble under pressure. And Peter also predicted that Peter himself would become a leader in the church, one of his stalwart apostles who would proclaim the gospel to the Gentiles. However, at this moment, Peter is worried that somehow he would be disqualified. And even though he runs to the shore and he's standing there at the foot of Christ and Jesus is cooking fish and bread, he is concerned that somehow he has been disqualified because of his betrayal. And so Jesus reinstates Peter in a wonderful way. The next slide, please. Thank you. In this beautiful masterpiece by Carl Bloch, the famous Danish painter. This was painted back, I believe, 1878, around that time. We see Peter, as Jesus is being led into Pilate's court, we see him denying Jesus, and he's in pain. It represents, this painting represents the human struggle of loyalty, faithfulness. How do I remain loyal in the face of possible personal destruction? And we see that all over Peter's face. He doesn't know what to do. And yet, in order to preserve himself, he says, "No, I don't know him. I don't know him." And the third time, the servant girl says, "Weren't you with him? You are one of him. I can tell by your accent." And then the cock crows. And just as Jesus predicted, the sound of the cock crowing in his ear, Peter runs and he weeps, as the scripture says, bitterly, in anguish over his own soul. Betrayal is hurtful for the betrayed, and betrayal is hurtful for the betrayer. It destroys both. How does Jesus tend? How does Jesus tend to Peter at this time? Knowing that Peter is struggling, knowing that Peter is gifted and just wants to do what is right, knowing that Peter has witnessed his wonderful ministry over the last 3 years, knowing that Peter understands that he's resurrected from the dead and this must be the Son of God, Emmanuel, God with us, he calls him to sit down at the table with him. You see, Jesus could have said, "You are no longer welcome, Peter, at any of my dinners. Look what you did. Look what you did to me in front of Pilate. You are no longer welcome at my table." And he could have said that to all of the disciples. But you see, Jesus' heart, God's heart, is much bigger than anything that you and I can do wrong. It doesn't matter if you are a betrayer or if you have been betrayed. God's heart can envelop and bring back and heal anything bigger than that. Anything you can conceive. As long as you pray like Peter does. What does Peter say in 1 Peter 5:6? "Humble yourself. Humble yourself, therefore, under God's mighty hand, so that in due time he will exalt you." And then he says, "Cast all your cares upon him." Peter's first exhortation to us, the church, is humble yourself. And so Peter humbly comes back to Jesus on the beach. And this is where he learned this lesson, the lesson that he wrote in 1 Peter 5:6. That if he comes to Jesus meekly, and if he sits down and listens to what Jesus has to say, "Do you love me, Peter?" "Yes, I love you." "Do you love me, Peter?" "Yes, I love you." "Do you love me, Peter?" "You know I love you." Then the real Peter starts to come out. "You know I do." The angry Peter starts to come out, doesn't he? On the third time. "You know I do. What's wrong with you, Lord? You know my heart." This wonderful story speaks to us today about the grace, the mercy, the wonderful forgiveness that we experience in Christ, no matter what we've done. One commentator says this: the disciples may have not wanted to have listened to a carpenter tell them how to be fishermen. I love that line. Here you have a carpenter telling fishermen how to fish. And they're like, "What?" Sometimes we have our own minds made up. We are so secure in how we do things and how we do ministry, in who is in and who is out. But if we will be fishermen who are willing to listen to a crucified carpenter and put our nets down on the other side, we will have and do more than we can contain. It's interesting when we try to do ministry on our own terms. What do I mean by that? Ministry on my own terms is like, I think I should do ministry this way, and I might be in disagreement with Susan over here or Joe over here because I want to do ministry my way. So we cast out the net on the one side, we don't catch anything, and then all of a sudden, Jesus comes along graciously and says, why don't you try ministry my way? What does Jesus' ministry my way mean? It means that we love above all things. We unite above all things rather than divide. We care rather than judge. I have suffered, as have many of you here, I know, this morning, under the current levels of division that we feel in the CRC. My heart breaks. When I read John 17 and I listen to the high priestly prayer of Jesus, when he says, Father, it is my prayer that they be united just as we are one. And when we become divided and we live in disunity and judgment, and we don't care about each other, even though we might have differences of opinion, we are disobeying the fundamental prayer of Jesus Christ, that we be one. That is not to say we don't discuss issues or we talk about things we don't agree on, but we stay together. We stay united, because what unites us, this man, Jesus Christ, is far greater than anything that can divide or disunify us. Where's the amens? Thank you. Our church is in danger of splitting down the middle, or one-third, two-thirds. That pains me, and it should pain you. It doesn't matter what I think about the report. What matters is that I love you and I care about you and I'm concerned for you. One of the things we teach at SoCo, the South Coast Beach Project, to our wonderful and beautiful young adults that come every summer to the Beach Project, which you heard about through Wilhelmina, is conflict stewardship. How to manage conflict when you don't agree with someone, especially in the church. How to have the right conversations so that even though you may disagree, you remain united under Christ. To do otherwise is to disobey Jesus. And so we say, Lord, help us. Help us to learn how to be united even though we disagree. Go feed my sheep, feed my lambs. The scripture, Jesus did not say to Peter, run away from that lamb. Kick that lamb out. Working hard without Jesus hardly works. Obedience to his voice always carries bigger results than hard work. All of this is to learn love. To love people as Jesus did. Feed, tend, care for his sheep, as he does so many times before his death, that even pre-death, pre-resurrection, as John's gospel says in the very next verse that we did not read this morning, the verse says that even all of the books, the earth cannot contain all the books that could be written about what Jesus did. God loves you, new life. He loves what you're doing here. He loves who you are. He loves the fact that you're getting a new pastor And it's my prayer that you go forward united. Go forward united under the banner of our risen King, under the banner of our Lord Jesus Christ, who prays continually for you and I, that we remain so. My hope is that breakfast on the beach for you, when you're eating breakfast with him, that you hear his voice saying, it doesn't matter what you've done. I know you feel shame and you're discouraged, but that doesn't matter. I am recommissioning you. I am sending you out. I am sending you out to love and care just as I did for you. So be recommissioned. Be reinstated. Be reinvigorated. That's what he's calling us to this morning. Because he's alive. Jesus is alive. He is risen. He is risen indeed. And he's calling you forward to follow him into a life of service, devoted to loving and caring. And all God's people say, amen. We are going to sing a beautiful song called the Servant Song. And it's an invitation to submission. It's an invitation to humility, of care, love towards each other. And I invite you to sing that with your whole heart this morning.
And let's stand as we do that.
Thank you.
I just also want to thank you, Kelly, for bringing the message to us this morning and for being a servant to this community and to God. At this time, we have an opportunity to bring of our offerings, and if you're a guest among us, please don't feel obligated to give. We are just thankful that you are here with us. The cause this morning is for Thrive, which is a ministry of the Christian Reformed Church, and this month, as it is in the United States in particular, and because we're a binational denomination, it is Abuse Prevention Month. And one of the ministries of Thrive is focused on that area. The Safe Church specialists at Thrive want to make note of some resources they offer both to Canadian and U.S. churches to be supportive of families and to help churches be active in preventing child abuse and neglect, as well as taking positive action to promote child and family well-being. You are invited to support the work of Thrive as they seek to inspire congregations to address abuse in ways that seek justice and healing for all those who have been impacted. May the Lord bless us, we give. Bless us as we give. And at this time, we have a couple of announcements. Dirk Kroon, you had an announcement. Dirk's always bringing up goodies to share in unique ways.
Did I hear somebody say, oh no? This is an announcement for the clothing closet. So, as some of you may know, Suzanne and her daughters are out in far-off lands, and she's left me to my own devices. Me and the cat, you know how that works. The cat takes over. He's leaving fur and footy prints all over my clothes. So in our domestic arrangement, after car repair and lawn maintenance, I'm pretty much useless. So she's trying to tell me how to use that magical device, you know, that cleans the clothes. And apparently, you need stuff with it, and so I've oh no, that's bleach. No matter what Donald Trump says, don't drink that. I did that once, it didn't end well. No, the clothing closet would like you to bring this. So we've been distributing clothes for free for 25 years. Now, our patrons sometimes don't have the resources to wash the clothes we give out. So for the next, you know, it was supposed to be this week. If you read the announcement in the, oh no, I'm not gonna say that. And you can bring, you know, detergent to the church, and our goal is 200, you know, containers. And then on May the 5th, we will celebrate together 25 years of the clothing closet.
And Brad.
Good morning. My name is Brad Wallace, and it's my pleasure to serve on New Life Council. And also a very exciting update this morning. As noted by Pastor Kelly, we had our vote of affirmation as a congregation last week, and we had a very overwhelming vote saying yes to move forward, which was virtually 100%. So then we voted, had a special vote to do an official motion as a council a couple nights later. And that vote was 9-0 to extend a call to Pastor Jeff Vandermeer. So I had some conversations last week. So very excited. He really wants to move forward. And we're very, very close. Just a couple of contractual details this week, which has essentially been agreed to. But really exciting news. And they're thrilled. And in terms of details of start, they'll be putting their house up for sale in Simcoe next week. And then so we agreed on mid-October for a start date just to give them time to relocate, find a house, and do a few different things. So I've had the good fortune to be very involved throughout the process, along with many of you, and I think he'll be a wonderful pastor and leader here at New Life, in particular to keep New Life strong and keep unity, and also I think his leadership and the fit will really help New Life prosper and grow into the future. So very exciting news, and once we have those last final details, we'll send out official notice last week, and so great news.
I forgot to make this sort of announcement or invitation after the baptism, but Robin and Zach and their family will be at the front after the service for anybody who wants to welcome Cole and say hello and congratulate them on the baptism.
And at this time, we invite Gary Van Ergon to lead us in the prayer of the people.
Please join me in prayer. We thank you, our loving God, that we can gather here this morning to experience community, to hear your word, and to praise you in sacrament, song, and prayer. We thank you that we could witness the baptism of Cole Alexander, and that in that moment we can see an example of your love for all of us, even for those of us who are so small that we really don't know what's going on. We thank you for the promises we made with Robin and Zach, and we pray that they may feel your guidance as they parent this child and bless us as we support them as a community as we are able. Thank you for your word this morning and for the reminder that you care for us and that you provide for us even when we may have turned away from you for any number of reasons. For some of us, this past week has been difficult. And we ask that even in the face of challenges, you will remind us of your presence. Give those of us who struggle with physical ailments, with stress, with loneliness and discouragement, an extra measure of your grace. And give us the willingness and courage to offer support when we see needs around us. We thank you for this church and for the ministries that we support. Grant that our efforts to serve you in this community and beyond may be a way in which your grace and love are shown to the world. We pray for our offerings this morning for this church and for our deacons and for the ministry of Thrive as we seek to address the horror of abuse of vulnerable people. We pray for those in this community who may have experienced abuse in their families, their schools, their workplaces, or even in their churches. Grant them the grace of healing and help us to provide support in compassionate and caring ways. We also pray for those who may be guilty of abusing others. We pray that they may have the courage to admit their guilt and to change their ways. We thank you for the good news that Brad just shared about our call to Pastor Jeff, and we pray for a blessing on Jeff and Deborah and their family as they relocate from Simcoe to Guelph. Grant that that process may go smoothly and that they too may settle in here well. We pray for the university students among us as they are dealing with year-end exams and assignments. Give them whatever they need to finish the year well. We pray for Sarah and her team at the University of Guelph as they provide support for those students who need that support in this stressful time. We also pray for the students among us who are approaching the end of their high school years and who are now facing the what now question. Guide them as they consider post-secondary options, be that in university or college or workplaces or a gap year. Give those of us who are in a position where we can be supportive, give us the grace and patience we need to support them well. We continue to plead for peace and for an end of the conflicts that we see in so many places around us. We pray for an end to the suffering in Gaza, in Israel, the Ukraine, Sudan, and so many other places. We pray for grace and courage for those who are doing what they can to promote peace and those who are working to provide food, water, and medicines to desperate people, even as we have seen again recently at terrible risks to themselves. We pray for a world in which all people are seen as your beloved children, worthy of respect and care. So as we go into this week, help each one of us to be a beacon of your light and hope in this world, so that somehow, as a result of who we are and of what we do and what we say, the world may become a slightly brighter place. We ask this in the hope that you will hear us and bless us. In Jesus' name, amen.
We have been reminded of and experienced God's love and mercy and compassion in a powerful way this morning. And as we sing our closing song, we're reminded again of different elements of that, aspects of that, and encouraged to share that with others, just as Gary closed his prayer. Shine your light and let the whole world see. Let's stand and sing together.
It was wonderful to be with you all this morning. And as you go into your week, remember that as Peter did and learned the hard way, that God is beyond all things love and care and concern for you. And hear these words as written by him in his epistle. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that in the proper time he may also exalt you. And casting all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Go in peace.